Thank you guys for being here. Me and Carlos went to the Reactive Conf conference in Prague in the later October, in start of November. So Reactive Conf is a three-day European-wide conference for web and mobile development. This year it happened in Prague, but on the first 3 years of the conference, it's happening in Bratislava. And it covers mostly reactive client technologies like React, Angular, Vue, and those types of technologies. So in the conference, in the venue, there was a board, a magnetic board, where we built a Tsuru, which is a kind of puzzle. Everyone had a small magnet, and a Tsuru, it's a puzzle where every square has the same size, so they all connect to form a bigger puzzle. So this was the start of the conference. It was like this. So we put ourselves there, out systems, and also there is Mendix down there. We found them. So we are not the only ones there representing low code. So regarding the presentation, so we'll share here not all the presentations that were that were presented there. We selected a few that were interesting. That we can use them for our product, for our experience, and so we will share them with you. But there's a link with all the talks, and if you have any questions, any more recommendations, you can come talk to us. That we'll be glad to help you. So the first presentation that I like to present you, it's a bit different from all the others. So a lot of talks were very technical, very specific to a technology. This one was from Bruno. He was a Portuguese guy, so it was really nice. It's not nothing like that, so it was more focused on experience. And the claim he did was users are getting more and more concerned about the user experience of their applications. They are being more demanding on how the applications behave. And there are several awards for the designs of applications. And usually the winners have something in common. They all have animations, very smooth animations, very pleasing to the eye. So he went and did a bit of ask why. So why are these so pleasing to the eye? Why does these do they work? And he watched a bit and he searched a bit and saw that what are animations? Animations are just the illusion of movement. So if it's an illusion, what we should do is how we trick the brain. And since we want to trick the brain, we need to understand how the brain works. So one of the things that he did on his presentation that I think it was really cool that I want to do here with you guys. It's an experiment and to check how smooth transitions work. So I will ask you to hold your head still, okay? And then try to move your eyes from the left to the right as slow as possible, as you can, with your head still, okay? Just do this really slowly. And if you can feel, your eyes kind of like do small jumps, right? When you go to one point to the other. So these small jumps are called saccades because the eyes are trying to focus one point at a time so that they can do the transition. So now let's do the same experiment, but now with your head still, hold your hand up high and without moving your head, look at your thumb and move your thumb very slowly. Can see it's much smoother now, right? That's because your brain has something to focus and to follow, so the transition is so much smoother. So this was one of the topics that he presented there, that we should on our application transitions should have a flow and help the user guide them what he should see and what he should follow. And also there are some kinds of transitions that sometimes mess things, some things go up, sometimes go down, and the user doesn't know what he should follow, so he kind of gets messed up. So we talked a lot about motion, vectors, what are the motions of the transitions, also the spatial navigation, how things move around. So this was a really interesting talk that I really recommend you guys to watch. So another presentation, more focused on performance, was about this guy. One experiment that he showed on his presentation was to compare how two types of applications with different target personas and target audiences can impact the performance of an application. For example, if you are developing a web application to work on a third world country, you will do some things that you won't do if you are developing for New York, for where everyone has an iPhone or the 4G always available. And always web developers tend to test their sites on their laptop or on their phone, which is really fast and everything works really great. But then when the end user tries to use it, it doesn't work. So I will show you the experiment that he did. So so what he did, I'll show you the feed for LinkedIn, and I'm throttling the speed of the network to kind of 2G, so you can see the experience of loading the mobile website of LinkedIn on 2G. So let's load it. So as you can see, you don't see anything. It's still a blank canvas. So 10 seconds has passed by and we don't see nothing, and we keep waiting and waiting. Now at 15 seconds, we see a LinkedIn logo and we are still waiting, and we need to wait for the content to come. As you can see, we are not used to test on these conditions, so we never think about this, but this is time that the user doesn't do nothing. It's just staring at a blank screen with just a logo, and it's still loading, as you can see. All right, we have some content. Let me just close this. But as you can see, we still don't have images. We are still loading the page. As you can see, we're loading just the faces now, and the post is still loading. We are still waiting for the page to load, and now it's finally finished loading. As you can see, after 60 seconds, we have the page fully loaded. Now I will show you another website, which is Tribo, which is from an hotel. It is a hotel from India. As you can see, on the same conditions, how does it load? So we are loading, and we already have some content, as you can see, and you can start using the page right away. Not even 10 seconds has passed, and we already have almost the page fully loaded. Just loading some images, and it's almost finishing by now. But as you can see, the page is fully loaded. You can start using it, and we don't have to wait for the page to load. And the page is fully loaded in 20 seconds. So as you can see, 1/3 of the time of LinkedIn, the page fully loaded. So this was really interesting. The target audience that the users have when developing their applications really impacts the performance of the application. So this is the comparison that he did. This other presentation also was focused on a performance mindset, but this one was not really focused on what improvements you can do on our specific application, what patterns should we use on our application, but rather what can we do generically on any web application to improve its performance. For example, we can do server-side rendering so that when the page goes to the client, there's already some content there that he can see. We can prioritize above the default content, which is we have some viewport and the page usually is very long. We need to scroll it, but we should always try to focus on rendering the things that are on the viewport, and then the things that are down there, they must be loaded afterwards. So for example, on the India site, what we see, it was rendered right away, and then it was rendering other images down there that we didn't see right away because we didn't need to. Other thing is to defer JavaScript execution, because if we execute JavaScript, we are delaying the parsing of HTML, so it will take longer to render. Also, optimize images for the mobile networks, and also just update your stack to HTTP2, because this way you can use the same request to fetch more resources, which also has a better performance. Now, this was all you. I think you guys understood all the things that we put here. Now we'll get in the part where we'll talk about state-of-the-art front-end technologies. Okay, so beware. Don't be afraid if you don't know what they mean, because we also felt like that on the conference. They were talking a lot of buzzwords that we were saying, what is this? React Redux, React Saga. Well, we are also like this, so don't worry. If you have any questions, please come talk to us. But we will try to give some context to you so that you can follow along. So this other presentation was about data fetching with higher order components. first, before getting into the presentation, he talked about GraphQL, which is a new standard that is coming up as opposed to REST. So in GraphQL, as you can see here, we just specify how our data is modeled. So we can see that we have authors, we have books. Then you just say that we can have a query that receives a book ID, and then we just retrieve that information. And as you can see down here, the client defines what information he retrieves. So instead of having the server define, you will receive all this information, the name, the author, the publisher, and all that. No, the client decides what information he wants, and he will only receive that. And that doesn't need to be implemented. As opposed to REST, for example, that we must define an endpoint, books, with an ID, and then we must specify all the fields that will go to the client. And if you want to add more, you need to modify this endpoint. So one of the advantages of GraphQL is that the description of our resources, the data, is separate from how we fetch them. So there is not coupled, and so we can use one instead of the other. We can get the information that we need instead of having to change the server. So with that in mind, GraphQL is being very adopted by new applications because, like I said, the client is not restricted by how the server was implemented. However, as you saw, this requires a change in technology, and there are a lot of applications today that are built on top of REST, like our applications. And so it's a lot of effort to transfer it to GraphQL. So he presented a library that can be an abstraction to how the data is fetched. This is a React component that should be used on the application that handles all the fetching, the cache, and the error handling of the fetching of the data. So this allows the presentational components, which are the components that are rendered, like our widgets, to just present the data. So they will live in a fairyland where the data is always available, because these components and these libraries will take care of the job of fetching it and retrying it and catch and all of that. So this could be useful for us to be used on aggregates and data actions. And also, I really like the presentation from this guy because he has a lot of puns and emojis on his presentation. So it was really nice also. This one, this presentation was not really interesting for us technologically, because it was really focused on using Realm and iOS. So I don't see us using it here, but he used the concept that I think it's really nice, and we could try to embed it in our platform, which is to use the local database as a source of truth. So what happens is the application only interacts with the local database, and then it changes its state and it reacts to its changes. And all the synchronization between the server and local database, it's done anywhere else by some other component. And this also allows an offline first approach, because since the application only knows the local database, if there is no network, the local database is still there. So it's a really nice concept. This could be used like for mobile development to help our users build synchronization patterns and offline first applications. Yeah.
What's Realm?
Realm is a technology to allow us to react to a database. It's more like a reactive database. Okay, that's why it allows the local database to be the source of truth. This was a sharing an experience about following the hype of React Native. So everyone already heard about React Native and that it is really great because you can develop applications for mobile devices with a single language. So they thought that, following the hype, that they would reuse all the UI that they did, and they would only need to do some fixes on the business logic. But in reality, what they needed to do was they had to rebuild all the components for both iOS and Android. So they had to rebuild all the components for both platforms. So they didn't reuse any of the UI and only reused the business logic. So, and other thing, it's everything was in JavaScript, so there was no CSS. So it's really hard also for designers, and to match sometimes the look and feel, it's really hard to match it. So these were my presentations that I followed. Now I will pass to Carlos.
So this presentation was about how to better use React components. So he started by splitting components into classes. The representational components that have no state, they just receive the data in props and render those props, and they have their job done. And the logic components that are stateful, they manage state, they manage the life cycle of the data in the application, and can have some dependencies for other components. And he provided some guidelines so we can reuse these components in a better way. So for representational components, what you need to worry about is style customization. They need to be easily customizable. If not, you cannot reuse it in different UIs. And to also prefer composition over configuration. That means you should create several components and compose ones inside the others to achieve a goal, instead of configuring a lot of adding a lot of configurations to a component so it reacts to how you want to render it, because that causes the component to be really bloated. So it's better to do some hierarchy of components than just do everything in one with configuration variables. And regarding logic components, they should only encapsulate logic. They should not render any UI, because that way you can reuse all the behavior and leave the UI for the representational components. So these actually, they are now calling these headless components because they don't render anything. A feature from React is React Context. These guys started moving their application to use this technology, mainly to solve this problem, that is the prop drilling problem, because you usually have a top-level component in React that has the application state and the data, and then it passes that data through the props from the components down the component tree until the leaf components, and sometimes many of those props are not even required by the intermediate components, but they need to reach the leaves. So the intermediate components still need to propagate that data. There are some techniques to prevent these. We can push the state to a singleton, and the components go to that singleton to fetch the data. We can try to compose the components in a different way to have a little less of this problem. We can use Redux. That is a framework to manage the application state and the updates of the UI. They opted to go for React Context. How does it work? In React Context, you can define a component that is the provider of the context, where you place some data. Then down the hierarchy, you have components that are consumers of that provider. And those consumers subscribe to that provider. And they can access the data that is on the provider on a context property. And then every time that data is changed, the consumer is notified and is rendered. This provides some benefits because now you don't have to pass the data through all the component hierarchy. So you can just render the components that are bound to the components that are consumers for that provider. And you don't need to re-render all the component tree. What was the best use cases where they find these useful? So usually in something that is more global, like a language or a team, if you change the team of an application, all the components that are bound to the team, they can receive that notification and change the visual aspect of it. Language, some user information, more global information, but they can also use it in application states, although it depends on how your application uses the state. If your state is used throughout all the components, then you don't gain much in going through this approach. But if you have several zones of your component tree that use several parts of the application state, then you can use several providers for those several parts of state, and the consumers are only listening to that parts of the state and only update as long as those parts update independently one from another. So they are listening to, they are registered on the provider, and the provider notifies the consumers.
So the question, the REST context is something that's built in React.
Yes. Okay. Another way to solve this would be Redux. It is another library that allows us to manage states and the React applications. And this presentation was about a little bit about this and other technology, which is MobX, that is done by Mendix, that manages states in a completely different way. So this guy was from Mendix. He was presenting this, and now they found themselves in a bit of a war between Redux and MobX, because they are two completely different technologies, and apparently they do the same. So we get a lot of comments on the community that saying that React is the way, React is really good, MobX sucks, it doesn't scale. And other people say, no, MobX is really cool. You can use it. It's very simple to use. Redux is just bloated. You need to do a lot of code just to do a simple thing. And you get these arguments on the internet.
We should not open source.
It's not a matter of open source. The technology is there and people can use it. And they have to decide which one to use. And his point, just to give you a little bit more of context about what are the differences between those. Redux uses immutable structures, and they have a unidirectional data flow. So you have the state of the application in the store that is rendered by the components. Then the components can perform some action with some parameters that are passed to some functions that are the reducers. The reducers take the state and those actions and those parameters and create a new state, which is a transformation of the current one. They send it back to the store, and the store notifies the components. They can re-render the new state of the application. So, the reducers don't change that structure. They create a new structure. They work with immutable data.
This would be something like model view controller and something to keep everything immutable. I think this is wrong.
More or less. MobX works based on observables and mutable structures. So you have a component that is observing certain parts of the data model, and then the component can change the data model. Those changes can perform an action on the data model. That action will cause the data model to mutate and change, and those parts that changed notify the component that something changed and it needs to be re-rendered. So it's not a clean flow. It's something much more interactive, and it's a completely different approach. So his point was that they are completely different approaches. There is not, and there for each problem, you may need one or another. There is not a one-size-fits-all solution. So you need to check what you're trying to create and see which approach is better for you. And just because you go for one and not for the other doesn't mean that the other is bad. It means just it's not fit for the use case you're trying to solve. So it doesn't mean it's a bad solution. And you can actually go there and see what they've done and see if you can actually find something there useful that you can use in your own solution to make it more complete. Because in the end, you just have to build something that is consistent and adequate to your use case. And it was that was their argument. Another one, because it was about a guy from PayPal, about a reappreciation of Redux, because there is also this general feeling that Redux is bloated. You need to do a lot of code so you can just do some simple things. And they, at some point, decided to try out a Polo client, which are components for a GraphQL. So they started using those components where they specify a query, and then they have a render method that, according to the feedback from the query, they can render that is loading or has some error or show the data. And that's at a certain point they started to miss Redux. First, because they Redux has already a lot of work on it, and they have really good tools like some time traveling on debugging, and also because the primitives are really simple, since they have those like actually on that graph. The actions, the reducers, the store, they have small components with really clear responsibilities. So it's much easier to manage and understand what each component is doing. And also because it promotes functional paradigm, which use per functions and pure functions and prevents you from, allows you to better work without using mutable data that you can't control very well the flow of the changes on your model and avoid some side effects. So they start moving back to Redux, and but also with a critical eye to only adopt those things that they really think are valuable in Redux and try to keep it less bloated than the usually the community complains about. And yep. That was the presentations. You can go back to the beginning of the presentation. You can go to the link and see the remaining presentations. There was some more. There was a little bit also about
blockchain.
There was a few talks about blockchain and some other stuff. If you want to go there. And at the end, we went back to the Tsuru. It should be more complete, so went back for a final picture. And there's still a lot of systems there, now smaller. And we looked, and we couldn't find Mannix. They disappeared.
Okay.
So it was like, whoa. And then we realized, oh, they love us so much. They decided to form a low-code cluster. And they just moved next to us. OK. That was the conference. The after hours, we took some time to travel, know the city. We got there the day before the conference, so we went for a little stroll. So this is Prague, and we were on that zone, which is basically this. So the conference was there on the right side, and our hotel was right next to the conference. It was nice to do to don't walk too much. But then we decided to go to the historic center, which is a bit further, and we did a nice stroll around the historic center. It was about 3 hours, right? Something like that, on a fast pace. It was really nice. There are really nice things to see. One of them is this bridge, this Charles Bridge, which is all stone and with these yellow lamps, really nice, with that black tower and the white buildings behind. It's a really nice view. But we actually went there on the end of October, so the weather was not that nice. This is more like a magazine picture. Reality was more like this. Still, it is a really nice city. If you can go there, go and visit. It has some really nice things to see. Like this astronomical clock, which is a very complex clock, actually has the pointers to tell you where the sun and the moon are and how are they aligned with the constellations. And they also have some dolls that go and move when the clock is ticking, when the clock is on the hour, and it starts, and we have some music too. But at that point, it gets like this. Everybody goes and watch the clock.
Just at the hour.
Yep.
Just
at the
hour.
Hour
is over.
Those 5 minutes where people just get there, it rings and everybody goes away. But it's really nice. They have a thing for torture museums. I do not understand why, but there are several. We didn't go there. And they have this traditional pastry, which is the Trdelnik, something like that, which is like a tube of pastry, and they usually eat it with coffee, or they stuff it with ice cream and cream, and they eat it in several ways. We actually never didn't try it.
I already tried it on Budapest.
Okay.
No, not there.
Okay. Okay. And these are the Czech people. They are not the most exuberant people. They always have a serious tone. Actually, in the conference, there were some awkward moments for the host, where he was trying to get people to cheer the presenters. Everybody was like, it was a bit awkward, but they are actually nice people when you talk to them. They are not too much out there. They are reserved.
There's also a really nice thing that during the conference at lunchtime, people would go lunch and then we go back. And there was just 5 minutes with a personal trainer just doing some exercise, stretching their arms, stretching their neck. And the guy was just like, okay, my neck. And so, he didn't pump the crowd to do the exercise. So it was really funny.
And there were also some more curious interactions, like we leaving a monument and asking the lady, "Hey, can you tell me where the bathroom is?" And she answers, "It's not here." And you get like, and she says, "No, it's not here." And, okay. So they are really practical, stick to the point people. They are nice. And that's all. Any questions you have? Any questions? Yep.
Go. Okay, so I didn't get most of the last part as expected, but the first off, it was really nice, and I actually like that demo, live demo when you're trying to load LinkedIn on Tuesday, and I was not so much surprised that the website from the hotel in India was fast, but it was really impressive the little things they did. So that they could receive that result. And I'm left wondering, are we going to try to apply that to our product? Because it really sounds awesome.
I'll surely look at it and I'll see what can we do or cannot. These solutions, it's easier because you have a well-defined application, so you can tweak that application to that point. In our case, where you create something where people just can create general applications, may be not that easy, but we can try to see what they do and what can we bring to the platform to improve our performance.
I understand that, of course. My question was more on the sense of trying to understand if there's some kind of follow-up on these things that you bring from the conference. This one seemed the most easier, was the same, because it doesn't involve chasing technology like the other talks that you mentioned that you would like to apply to mobile applications, for instance, that you said that you need to have a GraphQL and same stuff. That seems harder. This one seems a bit easier on that sense. But the general idea I wanted to get is, do we try to follow up in R&D when we go to this conference, try to see what we can apply to our product, what we cannot, design a roadmap for this, stuff like that?
Got this on the back of our minds, so when we are iterating over the next developments, we try to bring these ideas and see if we can manage to take some time to analyze them. I can tell from what I understood that actually the AI team actually was born a bit like this. I remember Ventura going to a AI summer school and then doing some presentations, and that issued a discussion about AI and start growing this initiative and the team. So yes, these conferences can influence what we do.
And that's what these thoughts are for also, to be good.
So yes, we have this on our minds and we'll keep an eye for this and see.
The other one that I talked about after that one, that was more generic stuff. I would really like to try that because they seem like really fast things, like for example, use HTTP2, just move the order of the JavaScript. I would like to try that, and if I have time, I would like to do it.
Okay, we had my Fridays.
Yeah, yeah. I want to do that. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
I was thinking if it is possible to use MobX with React Native.
MobX with React Native? Sure. I think it is, because they're not actually they do not depend on the problem between using React Native and React for Web. It's the React the visual components. So in web you have React DOM, where you have the definition of what is a div, a span, and stuff like that. MobX they don't go to that part. It's just the synchronization between the components and your model. So you almost for certain you can use it with React Native.
Funny thing, those are some of the questions that there are all throughout the talks. That just, oh, this is really nice technology. Does it work with that other technology? And yeah, a lot of technology that was really, really nice.
Okay.
Any more?
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
One more question?
Yeah, I had one. I just got here like 20 minutes ago, so I didn't get the first part. I just want to know if I read some articles online. There was a bit of debate, like, oh, GraphQL is the new REST. It's way better and stuff like that. I just wanted to know if they talked about that at that conference or not.
Yes, I can actually go back.
Yeah. Yeah. It's becoming the new trend to fetch resources, but there are also already a lot of applications in REST. So there are also some alternatives. I present here the differences between them, and there are some alternatives so that you can abstract the fetching of the data, which is one of the advantages of GraphQL, because you don't have to be bound to that data. So they talked about some of that stuff. Yeah. Thanks. Yeah.
Cool. Okay. Thank you.